In this clip, we will discuss a number of aspects that are related to the strong variation of turbulent diffusivities between day and night and with height. We will qualitatively discuss the mechanisms that are responsible for the production of turbulence. We will quantify the effect of buoyancy. And finally, we will introduce the concept of turbulent kinetic energy. Our final aim is to find a way to determine the fluxes of sensible and latent heat from vertical gradients of temperature and humidity. The factor that connects the flux to the gradient is the turbulent diffusivity. This diffusivity can be interpreted as the efficiency of the transport mechanism. Since the transport is taken care of by turbulence, we need to better understand turbulence if we want to understand the turbulent diffusivity. Our task is not simple. The graph shows how the observed turbulent diffusivity depends on the time of day, the horizontal axis, and on height above the surface, the three different lines. First, we see that the turbulent diffusivity varies strongly between day and night. Furthermore, we see that the diffusivity is smaller close to the surface than further above the surface. First, we focus our attention to the difference between day and night. This difference is related to the fact that during daytime, the surface is heated up, which in turn heats up the air close to the surface. Hence, during daytime, we have warm, low-density fluid close to the surface, below cooler, high-density fluid above. The result of this density difference is that the fluid starts to move upward and downward. Turbulence, mixing, and transport is the result. The occurrence of accelerations due to density differences in a gravity field is called buoyancy. We have seen what the qualitative effect is of buoyancy, but the question is if we could quantify the effect of buoyancy. We start from the equation of state. To simplify the analysis, we incorporate the effect of water vapor on the gas constant into the virtual temperature. At the same time, we replace the real gas constant by the gas constant for dry air. Since we are considering a turbulent flow, we need to decompose density and virtual temperature using Reynolds decomposition. This yields four terms. Of those four terms, two terms vanish because the mean of fluctuations are zero. Hence, we are left with two terms. Of those, the second term can be neglected. As a result, we obtain an expression for the mean pressure. This is the equation of state for the mean flow. Now we can obtain an expression for the pressure fluctuations. This is based on subtracting the mean equation of state from the full equation of state. The third term here turns out to be small. The last term is cancelled by the mean equation of state. As a result, we can express the relative pressure fluctuations in terms of relative fluctuations in virtual temperature and density. Let's summarize the results up to now. The next step is that, in fact, the relative pressure fluctuations are very small. As a result, the left-hand side vanishes. And then we can express relative density fluctuations in terms of relative virtual temperature fluctuations. This is a useful result, as it is easier to measure temperature fluctuations than density fluctuations. This is our main result, which we will use later on. Now that we know how to quantify density fluctuations, it is time to put this knowledge into action. We consider an air parcel with the density that is the sum of the mean density of the surrounding fluid plus a deviation from that mean state, rho prime. Gravity pulls the parcel downward based on the density of the parcel. On the other hand, an upward force acts on the parcel as well, related to the density of the displaced fluid. This is the Archimedes force. The net acceleration of the parcel is the net force divided by the mass of the parcel. The resulting expression is related to the relative density fluctuation. We have just seen how this can be related to the relative virtual temperature fluctuation. If the temperature of the parcel is larger than that of the surroundings, we see that the parcel is accelerated upwards. That is exactly what we already knew. Warm air tends to rise. But in order to understand whether this is an acceleration or a deceleration, we would need to know the original direction of motion. For the relatively warm parcel, the rising motion would be an acceleration if the parcel was already moving upward. But if it were moving downward, the buoyancy would decelerate the parcel. So now we have seen how buoyancy can produce turbulent motions, provided that the high temperature and low density air is located below the low temperature air. Once air has been vertically displaced, it will find itself in a surrounding where it will continue to move. Air that moves upwards ends up at a height where the temperature is lower and hence the density is higher, and as a result, the parcel will continue to rise upwards. However, buoyancy is not the only way to produce turbulence. A second mechanism is related to shear. Due to friction at the Earth's surface, the air moves slower close to the surface than further above the surface. These internal velocity differences, or shear, are the cause for turbulent motions. And buoyancy and shear can also work together, reinforcing each other in producing turbulence. However, buoyancy can also work the other way around. If the temperature close to the surface is lower than further away from the surface, vertical motion will be damped. If cold air moves up, it finds itself in the location where the ambient air is warmer and thus has a higher density, and as a result the parcel tends to move back to its original position. In this situation, shear is the producing turbulence mechanism, whereas buoyancy suppresses turbulence. Until now we have talked very qualitatively about turbulence, but let's see if we can quantify the amount of turbulence. Since turbulence is moving air, the way to quantify it should start with the velocity factor. The length of that factor is simply based on the three-dimensional version of the Pythagoras theorem. To quantify the amount of motion, we often use the kinetic energy. Well, for an object, this would be the square of the velocity times the mass of the object. However, for fluids, the mass is not easily identified, and therefore usually we use density to obtain the kinetic energy per unit volume. Or we could define the kinetic energy per unit mass, or specific kinetic energy. But now we need to take the step to a turbulent fluid. So we need to decompose the velocities into a mean and a deviating part. When we gather terms, we see that the part of the kinetic energy is the sum of the mean kinetic energy and the turbulent kinetic energy. Let's consider the three components of a turbulent velocity field. We clearly see that there is turbulent kinetic energy in each of the three components. We can summarize the turbulent fluctuations with a probability density function. Here, for simplicity, we assume that it is more or less Gaussian. The width of the probability density function is a measure for the amplitude of the turbulent fluctuations. In fact, the square root of the variance of a component is the standard deviation of that velocity component. Let's summarize what we have discussed. First, we have defined our challenge to explain the large variation of turbulent diffusivities as they are observed. For the time being, we have simplified that to the task to understand why the amount of turbulent mixing is variable. Next, we have quantified how buoyancy accelerates air parcels that have a density that differs from its surroundings. Then, we qualitatively discussed the effect of shear as a mechanism to produce turbulence, and buoyancy that can both produce and suppress turbulence. Finally, we introduce the concept of turbulent kinetic energy as a measure for the amount of turbulent motion. Now it is time to quantify how shear and buoyancy affect turbulence.